Greetings, everybody around the world, wherever you may be. You're very welcome to this edition of Capricorn Radio. This is your host, James Swagger, and for the next hour, we'll be getting into some fascinating topics. But before I do, you can check out the links for the live shows at capricornradio.com. We also have a new members area there. You can check out the full MP3 archive at capricornmembers.com. I'm introducing a special lifetime membership fee for Capricorn members. This will entitle you to Capricorn radio shows and Capricorn TV interviews. To sign up for the members area, head over to capricornmembers.com or equally follow the links on capricornradio.com. Don't forget you can also follow the Capricorn Radio YouTube channel, the Capricorn TV YouTube channel, and of course the Capricorn Radio TV Facebook group and Facebook pages. Or you can also follow what I do, James Swagger, in the James Swagger group on Facebook too. This is your host James, and I'm super excited today. I've got my returning guest, Mr. Gerald Clark, in the series of podcasts that we are doing. And if you haven't caught the other shows, I urge you to go into the Gerald Clark playlist or catch the archives at Capricorn Members, capricornradio.com. And you can also follow Gerald on his website, geraldclark77.com. And of course, Gerald's most recent book is Seventh Planet, Mercury Rising. And we're focusing on a lot of the information in that book and some background information. However, I have to say we're at a crucial point in the book that I am so excited to be waiting to get to. We've been battling through five shows to get here, and we are going to talk about the Emerald Tablets today. And I have to say, until I read Gerald's book, Seventh Planet, Mercury Rising, and the audiobook for that matter, I wasn't aware in detail of the Emerald Tablets, something I'd skimmed over in my research, and I can be forgiven for that, for all the research that I do. But these things are incredibly fascinating. No problem accepting the deep antiquity of these, but they seem to be murky and where they are now and their location. But here we are today. We're going to talk about these and focus on the work that Gerald has done in linking up the Emerald Tablets to other figureheads in our history and places on the globe. So without further ado, let's bring on today's guest. Hi, Gerald. Welcome back to Capricorn Radio.
Hey, brother. It's so good to be back again. I listened to the last show. It was so exciting, and I'm really, really excited about this one.
I find these shows so beneficial, Gerald, and I know the audience does too, because I'm getting great feedback. And I think that's the beautiful thing, is that there's a dissecting of the history going on, there's an analysis going on, there's an interpretation as well, Gerald, the important interpretation. I mean, I think that's unprecedented, to the depth at least anyway, Gerald, that you're doing. And like I say, that's a unique selling point that you have as an author, and I commend you on that. And that's what we're focusing on in these podcasts. And we're going to try and just, you know, get down to the nitty gritty and say, what does this all mean? That's the big one, Gerald.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, we're going to talk a little bit just in a while about man's search for meaning and a connection to a hero of the past, Viktor Frankl. But we'll save that for a minute, okay?
Oh, sure, sure. You know, Gerald, tell me, before we get into the Emerald Tablets, just tell me a little bit of background. How did you come across the Emerald Tablets? I'll just tell you how I came across them. I came across them in a search and I went, what on earth are these? And I skimmed past it and I just thought, oh, well, it's something I'll come back to. I didn't seem it worthy of anything. But and I think that's what happens with most people. They come across the Emerald Tablets and they find the story of them and the background information, and then they get into them, and it's incredibly mind-blowing. Tell me, first of all, how you came across the Emerald Tablets.
Well, it was about in the year 2004 when I was researching information on the Anunnaki, the Anunnaki of Nibiru, my first book. And I was putting together this god table, and these seminal names were showing up, Niburian names and Egyptian names, and one of those names, not to do them all right now, was Thoth, and it talked about how long Manetho discussed how long he ruled the first dynasty of Egypt. And about that time I ran across the name Thoth and discovered the Emerald Tablets by Doriel, and I didn't know who this Doriel was, and my first reading of it was cursory like yours, but something struck me in the reading, so much so that I decided to make a little 4 or 5 page Microsoft Word summary of the lessons I had garnered from it. And I carried this around with me for a while. I'm not sure why, but there were certain lessons in there that just really stuck with me. One of them was banishing darkness that shows up in tablet 6. But the ones that really struck me between the eyes were the supplemental tablets that were not supposed to be released until a specific time in history, the future time that Thoth declared. Or when he would come back and hold people accountable for it. That part was, those two tablets were 14 and 15. And we'll talk about the different organizations of the tablets and some history and all that kind of stuff in a minute. But so I ran across them about the year 2004. Mm-hmm. And I've probably read them multiple times. I've lost count. But I read them to the point where I felt like I understood them. And it doesn't happen the first time. And the thing about the nature of the tablets is the information is so incredible that it's even beyond our modern science, so much so that it was probably dismissed as fantasy. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But now that science has gotten to the place where we can look at it through a scientific perspective, I think the preludes I did to each tablet use that perspective, and I think you'll see that it all hangs together very, very well.
I think that's the most important thing you just said there, Gerald, was that now that the science has caught up and we're looking at these things, what the stuff and the information that's contained in those emerald tablets, you know, you just couldn't make that up in the past. It checks out on so many accounts. It just makes so much more sense when you look at it from the eyes of a scholar. And that's something, like I say, I skimmed over. I actually got forced to read it because it was in your book. So I commend you on that, Gerald, for putting it in there. I know why you did, and that's great. But like I say, it's something that people just find and they skim over and they just don't take it on or whatever. But I'm glad I did because I've really missed the boat on it. And the more I look at the Emerald Tablets and the more I read them, it's something, it just kind of hits you the first time. And then the second time you say, it's like anything, it's like any subject matter. You get hit with a wall of information, and then the second time you soak it in, and the third time you get real deep, profound meaning from it. Before I guess I continue any further, Gerald, let's, for those listening, and probably we've done enough to allure them now, but tell us what exactly the Emerald Tablets are. I know they've been lost to history now, but they are being translated in history and there are records of them. So tell us what they are, who wrote them, when, why, what did they look like, all that type of stuff, the physical story.
Okay, you want me to? Well, you want to stay on the physical story and not so much the historical story. Well,
just for the background for the audience who don't.
Okay, so what are the Emerald Tablets? According to Doriel, who says he got his hands on them circa 1925, there were 15 total tablets, and he was allowed to release 13 of them until a certain time. Okay, so with that, telling that story, the first thing in your mind is, well, where were they and all that kind of stuff. So let's stay on the physical right now, and then we'll kind of walk through the pathway they've taken and the connection to the Mayan calendar, okay? So supposedly they're emerald green tablets that are written in the ancient Atlantean script, which is done in a way that's rhythmic and causes a mental frequency to occur when you hear them. So that's the other thing that's important about the Emerald Tablets, is you can read them and only get so much, but when you read them aloud or listen to the audio, they're done to a specific rhythm that causes mental entrainment that supposedly, according to the writing, triggers a conscious movement of your soul that releases a deep wisdom and an understanding that's already endemic in us all. So it's really, really profound from that standpoint. So we started out, Doriel says he got these, the direction as the supreme member or the supreme voice of White Temple or the Egyptian Therapeutate. Okay, so this is the Egyptian priesthood that Thoth assigned to guard these tablets. He asserts that he was a member of that organization, and that's why he was directed in 1925 to go get them. And this is the kind of an interesting story. I'll go ahead and tell it. You realize in Mexico and the Yucatan and in South America, according to the history in the tablets, that the Mayan civilizations were there. So they started in South America and migrated over to the Yucatan, according to this. I didn't know that. Well, about, the 1500s, when the Spaniards came over to Mexico, the Mayan civilization was decimated. So a lot of the temples and things were abandoned. Well, it turns out that according to Doreal, the Emerald Tablets of Thoth had been brought with him to the Yucatan, as we discussed last time, or a couple of times ago. His other name was Quetzalcoatl. So now all of a sudden you realize there's a connection between Egypt and the Yucatan that's so profound. Well, Doreal says that the tablets in 1925 he was directed to go get were in one of those lost temples that was decimated and forgotten about after the Spanish conquest of Mexico. Okay, well, mm-hmm. That place turned out to be one of the great temples of the sun, and the headquarters of the Mayan civilization at that time was at Teotihuacan, just outside of Mexico, not Tenochtitlan, which is in the center of Mexico, which Quetzalcoatl also had a temple. Well, the Temple of the Sun and the Temple of the Moon is at Teotihuacan. And not long ago, they discovered a tunnel underneath Teotihuacan where Quetzalcoatl had a significant pyramid structure that was overlooking that area that was separating the Temple of the Sun and the Moon along the Avenue of the Dead. Well, this was probably the place where Doreal recovered these tablets. Now, he originally says there were 10 tablets, these emerald green tablets. And when he translated them, he turned it into originally 13 tablets and then added the two supplements later. That's why we have 15. So my book has all 15 of them, okay? Now, the other kind of interesting part about that is there was an allusion to the document about how it was organized originally. Well, originally it was organized into what was called 7 rubrics. And rubrio is a Latin word that means red. And it also ties to the substance orichalcum that was surrounding the pillars of Atlantis. So mm-hmm. You're going to see that the tablets were written by Thoth the Atlantean. Okay, so you're like, wow, okay, Thoth was an Atlantean, but he was also a god in Egypt. Interesting, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
we get the 7 rubrics that are actually dealing with consciousness, vertical relationships between matter and spirit. It describes in the third rubric, it describes the universal life force. Well, now we're getting into alchemy big time, because in this one, it breaks down the 4 elements, correlating fire with calcination, water with dissolution, air with separation, and earth with conjunction. And people that are into alchemy know what those terms mean, okay? So all of a sudden, he's basically disclosing that he's not only the first alchemist, but he's doing it with 7 rubrics, and he also gives you the 7 main elements of alchemy. Okay, so in the next rubric, he talks about entering the spiritual realm, or the above. Okay, now this is, we're going to get into that. There's several allusions to that, but when you use the word above, you go, well, okay, is there above and a below? Is there a separation? And as you're going to see eventually, on the earth, we are enveloped in what's called the below the other dimensions that are higher than us. And we get real specific about what that means, okay? So we'll just keep the idea of above and below, and we'll take it even a step further, and we'll call the below the holographic universe where we're enslaved in our current consciousness. All right, I'll just put that out there. So in the 4th rubric, in the above, he finishes off the 7 alchemy elements of fermentation, distillation, and coagulation. And Krista, being an alchemist, is sitting over here smiling because she knows exactly what I'm talking about. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
So the 5th rubric, this is original organization of the tablets, okay? There was a pure quintessence resulting from the last rubric. In other words, it's an accumulation of all the previous 4 rubrics. The 6th one gave you a meta perspective that leads to a transformation in your consciousness so that you can either distinguish and participate in a multidimensional reality. So eventually we're going to talk about the worlds within worlds that ties us back to the Mayans again, okay?
Mm-hmm.
So in that rubric, endemic are the laws of the evolution of matter and the forces in nature. So it's very, very profound. And then the last rubric, it really kind of goes into talking about who Thoth is as an immortal and that he was called thrice great Hermes for a particular reason, because he had conquered the physical, the mental, and the spiritual realms of reality. Okay. I used to think it meant his number of incarnations, but then I saw the tables from Edgar Cayce and my own research to realize he had so many other names and incarnations. I was struggling with, well, is that the prolongation of one body through all this time, or is it multiple incarnations in other bodies? Well, it turns out he can do both, so it's really crazy.
Wow.
Okay.
This is incredible stuff, Gerald. The structure of the...
It's absolutely amazing.
The structure of the Rubik's, the structure of the information, as well as the paragraphs, if you want to call them that, or the way it's spoken as well, and you get that effect. We're going to play that at the end of the show anyway. But the spoken word, as they say, the embodiment of the alchemical knowledge plus the structure of the prose on the tablet as well. This is incredible stuff. I mean, how far back into history does this stuff go? I mean, there's from my own research, I'm just looking at there's translations from Newton. Newton was a known alchemist. Perhaps that's probably where he got his alchemy craze from. Perhaps this source of stuff. Do we know how far back into history this goes? Obviously, it goes back to the source, but...
Well, he tells you in the history of the tablets and discloses... it's hard to go, okay, back to the source of when this started without talking about Atlantis. So let's put Atlantis off for just a little bit, but just know that Thoth was an Atlantean. Atlantis was destroyed, and during that destruction, his father ordered him to go to the land of Cam and do a mission. Well, he says he left Atlantis 50,000 BCE. And ruled over Egypt for what looks like until 36,000 BCE, when he apparently descended into the halls of Amenti to renew his body. And this is something in the tablet you'll see later. He does it out of 1,000 years. He has to go there for 100 years to renew. Yeah, that's kind of crazy. So, and he says he's done that 1,000 times. Okay, that means in the current body that he's in is Thoth. He's been doing it for 100,000 years. Okay, that may sound incredible, but you go look at the Sumerian kings list and see how long some of those rules were ruling. And like I told you, the one at Bad Tabir served 12 shards, which is about 43,000 years. So so this is incredible stuff, okay?
So it's on a par with the Anunnaki kings list and time frames, really.
Well, exactly. Well, Thoth the Atlantean was Enki's son, who was from Nibiru, and he also had other names, as I told you before, in the Enuma Elish, which was the Babylonian epic of creation, according to the Anunnaki that was given to the Sumerians. He had a name in that account as well, along with Ea, Enki, and Nudimmud, okay? Well, his name was Mumu, which equated him with the planet Mercury in the table in my first book, The Anunnaki of Nibiru. Okay, so the fact that the alchemy esteems the mystical element of Mercury, a liquid metal that can be in multiple different states, mm-hmm. You know, it could be in a vapor state, its natural form is in a liquid state, but it's a crazy substance. It doesn't emit its own light. It reflects only what it's exposed to. It can absorb other metals. It's really an amazing
material. Exotic, Gerald. It's an exotic substance.
Yeah, well, it also shows up in the toroid shape engines of the Vimanas as spinning mercury. And so even the founder of the Qin dynasty created a whole underground city representing of his capital, where he had mercury rivers flowing in it. And apparently he was consuming the stuff too that had led to his early demise.
Did you ever hear the phrase mad as a hatter?
Sure.
That comes from...
mercury poisoning?
Yeah, they used to get the red cinnabar and process it for dye to dye hats. And as a result, they would all have mercury poisoning, going literally insane with heavy metals on. So wow. the people who made the red hats became mad as a hatter, like, basically.
That's interesting. The concept of cinnabar and what shows up in the Magnus card has my attention. I'm going to have to go back and look at that, because he talks about that in his process of doing the laws of continuous creation while he's holding his scepter at the table. It's crazy. Anyway, So 50,000 years ago, Thoth leaves Atlantis as Thoth the Atlantean, and he talks about his youth there in a later tablet. Okay, and up to 36,000 BCE, where this is really key to me, and I got very confused, and I only found the answer today. I have stated multiple times that Thoth built the Giza pyramid and the Sphinx to commemorate it as an above-ground structure in the Giza complex. Okay, well, a lot of people have looked at the Sphinx, looked at rain erosion, and tried to establish through archaeoastronomy and other things, documents, mm-hmm. when the pyramids built. Okay, well, I was of the opinion, based on the Emerald Tablet reading, that he built them. He did it in the age of Leo, because you see the Sphinx is the lion's body. That's clearly a zodiacal sign. And then it has his face on it, which is kind of disfigured after Napoleon went over there and multiple others and were firing cannons at it, trying to break off the beard and everything else. That's why it's been reconstructed. It's been under attack. And speaking of that, bringing us current just for devastating cultural sake, knowing that the Mosul Library was just ransacked and over 8,000 books and ancient scripts of Sumerian origin and cuneiform script were destroyed by ISIS. Okay, their next statement, just a couple, not even a week ago, from their religious leader and their military leader was the Giza complex is next. Mm-hmm. So, wow, that's unbelievable, okay? But it has precedence in history. You know, Napoleon went over and did it, and I'm sure others have as well. Maybe Saladin, I'll have to look. So getting back to the history. So these tablets ended up in this temple, Teotihuacan, under the Pyramid of the Sun. That's why that's so important to me, and I was hoping to do another show from that spot with you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They were recovered 1925 by Dorial under the direction of the White Temple, the Egyptian Therapeutate, the priesthood, okay? Well, he took them, translated them into these 15 tablets, and then, according to his instructions, they have not put these complex, and most people believe that the Sphinx. Well, he tells, so about 1925, he was directed to go get these emerald tablets from beneath the Temple of Teotihuacan, and like I said, they discovered the underground chamber there not long ago. He did his translation into these original 13 tablets, which started from a different organization. This is his organization, okay? And then withheld the tablets 14 and 15 until a later time. So by the time I got to the Emerald Tablets in 2004, 14 and 15 were included. So I'm not sure exactly when 14 and 15 were made available, okay? So from that point, he did his translation, released his document, and according to him, it's been released since 1930. Wow. And then he did not return the tablets to Teotihuacan, but was directed to put them back into the Giza complex. Now, later in the tablets, you're going to see Thoth tells you where they were actually put and gives you almost like a scavenger hunt bunch of clues to go and get them, which was really interesting.
Wow. You know, this is a... People are going to say, well, Thoth, Egyptian, like Flood, Atlantis, and then to Central America. This is, I just draw attention, like, I mean, the Epic of Gilgamesh, which we covered the Flood, and we also had, you know, the Atlantis story with the Flood.
Yeah.
Are we talking exactly. We're talking gel of knowledge here. This is not a big reach for me. I think if somebody has traveled from Nibiru to come here and land on our planet and set up a civilization, I don't think it's a big problem for them to either go to Egypt or another country, what we would have these boundaries today. But it seems to be for some people, Gerald, they find it hard to accept this stuff, like, or at least look at it anyway.
Well, the part that's hard to accept is when you read in the Emerald Tablets, when Thoth left Atlantis, he took all his advanced magic tools and weapons, got into a craft with the survivors of Atlantis, and then went to the land of Cam. So all of a sudden, you're like, wait, what kind of aircraft was he in? He tells him which direction they flew and who told him to do it and what his mission was. His mission was to go to the land of Cam, implement the plan his father had for him to preserve the knowledge that was lost on the pillars of Atlantis and their records, and reestablish the primitive workers on a pathway to higher consciousness, and that's what he did. And it never stopped. His mission never stopped in doing that.
Mm. You know, I think a lot of people have this sanitized version of the ancient world. I was only looking at this tablet in the British Museum the last time I was in London, Gerald. And basically, it's a Sumerian tablet that was brought to Egypt where they were begging the Egyptian pharaoh for gold. Typically dated this to 1500 BC, but the point is, why would they write cuneiform script to give it to somebody who couldn't read it? I don't get that. You know, why would you... You know, and even just on that single point alone, that tells you either there was a cross body of knowledge, they both had Sumerian... I mean, there's cylinder seals in ancient Egypt too, but you don't see them in the museums. You don't get these... you know, concepts given to you. You're told that Sumer's over there and Egypt's over there and nobody was talking to anybody. Even though it's in the actual record, even recently.
Well, here's the link for me. And I think that's what got me to read the and find out who Thoth was, because I really didn't know. I started from the Enuma Elish and went forward. Mm-hmm. And then I found out his Sumerian name in the Atrahasis was Ningishida. Well, also, last show, we just had another name for him, remember, in the Adapa tale. His name was Gazeta. Mm-hmm. Okay, well, this is the same being, okay? And like I said, he has a large AKA list. He was Hermes to the Greeks, Mercury to the Romans, Thoth to the Egyptians, and also Thoth in Atlantis. And he has many other names. He was known as Melchizedek. I have information to show that his incarnation was probably as Buddha as well. Mm-hmm. And the most controversial one for the Christians was Jesus was an incarnation of Ningshida. Mm-hmm. So that's hard to believe, but then you find out that Jesus was gone for 20 something years down in Egypt. He was documented as being in the mystery school, and he became the chief priest of the Therapeutate. Well, who was that? That was Thoth. So you just put two and two together, and all of a sudden, this being who was in the Enuma Elish is showing up in the profound cross points where man is searching for meaning.
Mm. You know, you mentioned Adapa there. Just to recap on last week's show, Gerald, or fortnight ago, couldn't help. I was just during the week, I couldn't help feeling sorry for Adapa. I feel bad for little Adapa and getting marched around like I'm paraded around like a lesser being. You know,
I'm with you on that. And somebody sent me an anonymous message not long ago. I read it. It was supposedly from Enki himself. It's not very long. It's only about 6 minutes. And I read it. And there were some things in it that made me go, wait, only somebody with some really deep understanding of Sumerian tales, the Enuma Elish, the Adapa tale, that relationship where he had him cower in front of Anu, only somebody who knew all of that could have put this together. Okay, so I decided to turn it into an audio just so I could listen to it and see if it sounded different than when I read it. And I ended up hanging on to it, and it still, we listened to it again today, and every time I listen to it, things get corroborated. So I'm not saying that whoever did it was actually Enki, but all indications are that somebody at a very ancient knowledge had to have done that. Mm-hmm. That or they were so ensconced in this knowledge that they tried to play a prank. But I'm telling you, I don't see the motive or the intent for that to be the case. It truly looks like it was a serious message for mankind. And I put it on my Gerald Clark 77 page under the seventh planet Mercury Rising tab. Right at the bottom, there's an audio file there you can just click on. And I gave some notes about the names he used and some of the deep knowledge that he exposed. And there was some other stuff, too. But I think it's very interesting. And then you find out, of course, and we have to reiterate this from the God table, that Ningshida Thoth was Enki's son, the Caduceus carrier. And we did this in a much earlier show. Okay, so he actually ended up being the one who's representing alchemy now and has a mission to wake people up. So he kind of derogatorily alludes to these barbarians of the land of Cam, Egypt, that he's tasked to go and raise to a higher state. Well, an interesting story. Well, actually, let me finish that, and then I want to go back to the construct of the Emerald Tablets. I'll do it now. One of the other crazy things about the tablets is they're supposedly alchemically created and such that they defy the law of oxidation, meaning the molecular bonding is unbreakable. So keep that in mind. So he's bringing this ancient knowledge from Atlantis, from his father. Remember the twin pillars of Atlantis? I think we read this from the Critias, where we talked about the destruction of Atlantis at some point. If we haven't, we'll do it again.
Sure.
So he's going to the land of Egypt, and he gets there, and he runs into a bunch of barbarians. Okay, and about that time, they approach him and try to attack him and his crew with spears and cudgels, as he describes. Well, he does something really funny here. He doesn't kill them. He uses a advanced Atlantean weapon on them and uses by frequency through the electromagnetic spectrum, freezes them all in place like stone. Wow! And while they're still frozen, apparently their eyes and ears and their senses are still working. And then he puts on a magic display of signs for them, such that when he's done and releases them, they're at his feet groveling, okay? So that's how it started, according to the beginning of his mission. Imagine getting that mission to have to wake those people up.
You know, all the stuff that we had described in the first shows, Gerald, it really makes much more sense now. If Thoth the Atlantean can incarnate at will into whatever form he wants, whether that's body or just incarnate again, this is incredibly powerful stuff. This even explains the whole Egyptian obsession with the body and the afterlife and everything that these guys were.
Well, exactly. Now you go back to these this original thing we talked about, where in the I guess it was the fourth rubric, where he's talking about entering the spiritual realm. Well, this, and I think I've mentioned this a couple of times for people that know about alchemy, in order to participate, he mentions this golden thread through time and what the two requisites are to participate in this fourth rubric, which is the above, this vertical relationship, right? And, it's a Sorcerer's Stone by Dennis Hauck, H-A-U-C-K, mm-hmm. Sorry. Anyway, that was the purification of your consciousness and the subjugation of your ego. Well, that shows up in Tibetan Buddhism, okay?
Oh, yeah.
Subjugating the ego is a lifelong process in that philosophical thinking. Well, the other part of that is purification of consciousness. And while I'm on that topic, before we go any further with this, I want you to think about, what does that mean? Does that mean to quit swearing in front of your family? Well, maybe. Does it mean not thinking bad thoughts? Probably. What does it have to do with energy? Because we just said multiple times that energy and consciousness, as quantized in your chakras, are indistinguishable. So energy and matter, where they intersect, is the place we want to focus. Okay?
Wow.
So do you understand what I'm saying?
It's incredible. This is incredible, Gerald.
Yeah, so one theme that came out for me as an electrical engineer, it was probably more natural for me reading these Emerald Tablets, was they make, right in the introduction, he talks about figure out what the difference between energy and matter is. And this shows up in the rubric as well. And if you do that, then the mystery of unveiling the holographic enslavement that we're in reveals itself.
I wanted to focus on the time frame anyway.
Okay, yeah.
This long epoch, going back a whole procession cycle, you know, of course, there's my good friend Robert Boval, you know, with the Orion correlation theory, mm-hmm. and the supposition that the Sphinx is about 10,500 BC. However, I know there's other people, and I'm probably mentioned John Anthony West, probably he's a great example, because he actually thinks it's gone back one full processional cycle. So in other words, 10,500 BC plus a full processional cycle, which would put it in that realm. It would.
Yeah, I sent you a document today to show you. I kind of back annotated, not using the equivalent zodiacal house, but the actual transit times that are on that document I sent you, okay?
Yeah.
So this is another way of looking at the zodiac. Well, this one's more accurate, by the way. Mm-hmm. Well, we had 10,853 BCE. It was the first processional backtracking to the age of Leo. Mm-hmm. And that's when everybody believes the Sphinx was built because it was the Leo was the lion, and that Sphinx had a lion body, and that was pretty clear to most people. Well, all of a sudden now, the Emerald Tablets brings up this idea that in the 36,000 BC, that Thoth left the land of Cam, at which point he stated he built the Giza complex and the Sphinx in order to commemorate a location for the Halls of Amenti. And this is where it gets really crazy. So 36,000 BC. Well, now go back one more full turn around the zodiacal wheel using the non-equivalence house that I sent you, and you land at 36,400 something BC. You know, and I approximated. I just did it real quickly. I didn't put the decimal points at the end of it and add it all up. But I just approximated real quick to make sure this correlated. And this is even more astounding.
You know, this...
what I'm telling you is, according to the zodiacal house in the age of Leo, the second time around, and Thoth's writing, he built that 36,000, not 10,000 BCE. 36,000 BCE.
I mean, the whole hypothesis of the 10,500 BCE is just the first processional date, but by its own theory, it could be another 1, 2, 3, 4 processional cycles. It could be any number of those in a fractal loop. But it's
given
interesting.
The fact that you understand archaeoastronomy, you know that. Well, now all of a sudden you've got the writing from him directly. This is out of his mouth, the builder said when he did it. And it correlates with the age of Leo. And that was the key thing for me, is it had to correlate with the Sphinx because it was in the age of Leo.
And by the way,
he says it was his face on the Sphinx as well.
Another thing, Gerald, is, I mean, 10,500 BC, we know from the geological record that was the Ice Age. And you just don't build things like that in an Ice Age. I reckon people were surviving on the planet. I just think it had to be another processional cycle. I mean, you look at the Great Pyramid as well. I mean, all the dating of the Great Pyramid is a shambles. It's founded on very, very, very shaky, murky, clandestine, surreptitious facts.
Well, the whole idea that Cheops built it is a complete lie.
Yeah. Well, no, I was trying to be kind.
I remember where I was going a little bit ago, and I'm not sure you want to go here, but speaking of the hidden mystery of Egypt and connecting Thoth leaving Atlantis and coming over to that area in the land of Kem to wake up these barbarians, a guy named Dr. Hertok was the recipient of some underground surveillance radar data that was generated over a 30-year period by the president of Egypt at the time. This is 1978, Anwar Sadat. And according to him, they had secret images of massive multi-layer complexes beneath Giza, indicating that the pyramid and the Sphinx were just small artifacts indicating what's really underground. And this is the area that he calls the Halls of Amenti, okay? Wow. So he says he created this film that that's going to be released at the end of the century. And I'm like, what? Go show it to us now. That actually shows underground chambers at multiple levels that fills the entire Nile Valley. Wow.
There's a lot of people
that got built by Thoth when he came over from Atlantis underground, where he says the Halls of Amenti are.
There's a lot of people think there's probably 70% of ancient Egypt still buried in the sand. It's actually another point worth noting that the Great Pyramid's base is not actually perfectly square. It's actually built on top of an older structure, what looks like to be a rectangular base. A lot of people think that may have been rebuilt on top of another monument or another older monument. Of course, then, like you say, the face has been recarved clearly, showing deep antiquity as well. So I definitely think we're looking at layers of tampered history. And then you have, you know, the modern scholars looking at this having a, quote, all figured out, even though, I mean, their own king's list is compiled from many different sources, and the chronology is clearly flawed from the Turin Papyrus. And like I mentioned, also the Ice Age thing as well. I mean, you just don't build things like
that's a very good point. I know they were talking about rain eroding the Sphinx, causing the channels, water lines, and all this kind of stuff. But now, all of a sudden, it takes you back a whole nother zodiacal cycle, and you got to reevaluate what was going on the Earth in terms of ice ages. You know, it seems like about every half of a great year, you end up in an ice age. So it's about 13,000 years.
Yeah. Wow.
One other thing I wanted to bring out about this is the significant connection between Thoth and the Mayan culture. According to the writings, the Mayans were... And what happened was, apparently, the priesthood from Egypt, around 1500 BC, was dispersed with the ancient knowledge to go to different parts of the world. Well, some of them landed in South America with the Mayas that then ended up in the Yucatan. So it kind of didn't jive with me, because I know the Mayan calendar started about 3114 BC. So what he must have arrived, they must have arrived earlier than that, okay? But this brings up Ian Lundgold's deep understanding of the Mayan calendar and all the lessons about our galactic timing and the evolution of consciousness. And we've talked about this false flag 2012 thing. Well, the document I sent to you from Ian Lundgold, which I believe is correct, and he timed it with the right Bakhtun, and I think it was Bakhtun 13. I got to go look again. He was the expert before he died. Okay, but the idea that there was a correlation between the Mayan calendar and universal consciousness, and it has a lot to do with these emerald tablets and the knowledge that's in here. Okay, now one other thing to kind of tie back to the last show. It may not have been clear to people why I introduced the hillbilly rules of learning in chapter three. Well, the reason I did that is because he asks you to read these emerald tablets 100 times to get the wisdom. It's that important. Okay? So if you got a way to apply these learning rules and get it, and you can get it in 20 times instead of 100, well, that saves you a lot of time. Okay, so don't forget those hillbilly rules of learning when you're reading the Emerald Tablets. And also, now that you know that they're attuned to an Atlantean rhythm that changes the mind, your mental frequency, accessing deep knowledge within your soul that from your archetypal design, it's good to listen to it, read it out loud, or use the audio. Do it in combination. Read it and listen at the same time. Okay? So make this really important, not something you cursory look over. Oh, yeah, it might elicit a feeling of beauty in the poetic nature of it. It's much deeper than that.
How important is the two supplemental tablets, Gerald? Are they like the icing on the cake? Are they any way different to the other 13, or are they all equally important?
Well, actually, they're the icing on the cake, and there's knowledge in those about. We're getting ahead of ourselves because we're going to do those later.
No, we'll do them later. Just deep, in terms of curiosity.
Deep knowledge in there, and word keys that'll allow you access to various levels in the multidimensional reality. Okay, mm-hmm. So in other words, the last tablets, if for the serious student, okay, who takes this on and practices and learns this stuff. There's a way out of the holographic simulator to a higher ascension level, and that's it in 14 and 15.
You know, the Egyptians themselves say, and this is from Solon, that they come from an older civilization, and very ancient civilization, and the Egyptologists profess to know more than the ancient Egyptians themselves. You know, it's as simple as that. And you can look at whatever text, the Turin Propers, and say, oh, there's a lot of problems with the chronology. But basically, the Egyptologists profess to know more than the ancient Egyptians themselves, which is, you know, it's mind-blowing.
Well, yeah. Well, the priesthood always held close guard to the knowledge. And that's another thing I want to bring about the tablets. When Thoth was originally addressing his audience in the land of Kem, he was talking to the priest of this white temple. They called him the Egyptian therapeutate, these priests, okay, mm-hmm. who were there to guard this knowledge that he had given them on these tablets. Did I answer your question, or did I take you off track?
Sure, no, a little bit. You know, I'm also thinking about underneath the Giza Plateau here in a physical sense. I think personally the Hall of Records is there. I think there's definitely stuff underneath that plateau, and you know, Casey was probably right. I think Casey was right on the money.
Well, yeah, well, it corroborated with what Thoth told you was there. He tells you they're there, and he actually sends you on a little scavenger hunt later in the tablets to find it.
I've looked at some of the accounts of Edgar Casey, and some of the stuff that he was able to predict is really, really, really bizarre. I mean, some very specific stuff. He didn't even know he was doing it. You know, he'd wake up from the sleep and ask, what happened? What's the details? What happened?
Oh, I know. I think he's the most significant, credible prophet. Or medium, if whatever you want to call it.
I don't know what you would call him.
That I have ever encountered, okay?
Yeah, I don't know what you would call him, a prophet, a psychic, or a medium, one or the other. I mean, yeah.
Probably all three,
yeah.
Okay, so we've talked about the organization, the tablets. They're immutable. They have this ancient knowledge that covers all aspects of the construct of man, his relationship to matter, and the way out. It's absolutely incredible. And I want to ping on Ian Lungle just one more time quickly. According to him, October of 2011 was the time when we all were given access based on the energetic access to the galactic center, our latent circuits probably that we talked about that Thoth and Ishida programmed into us in the Atrahasis, mm-hmm. and this idea of the timing and the change of the zodiacal house. So what if they all corroborated at the same time? So everybody's been asking me, well, when did the age of Aquarius start? Because that's supposedly when Thoth takes over the council command on the Anunnaki Council, according to me and many others, okay?
Sure.
So when does it start? Well, I was researching this just real quickly before the show to see when we entered the first degree of Aquarius. And this came from crystallinks.com under procession.html for people that want to go look at it. And based on their description, which I think is quite good, that he believed that we entered the first degree of Aquarius in 2013. And I think that's correct. Even though the Mayan calendar showed that we entered the highest state of universal consciousness in October 2011. And then from that date forward, in the document I sent you from Lungold, he talks about these various evolutionary steps in consciousness that happened between the 6 days of darkness and 7 days of light that started October 2011 and go forward. Okay, so it's quite interesting. So I believe we are in the first degree of Aquarius, and that's why you're seeing the massive changes on the planet, because there's a zodiacal house change, meaning there's an Anunnaki council change going on for the rank 50, Lord of the Earth. And my premise is, and I've said this all along, and I've never changed my stance, that Thoth, Ningxida, Yeshua, Jesus, whatever name you want to call him by, it's his turn. It's his turn. And you're going to see major, major changes on the Earth relative to an Enkiite in charge versus an Enlilite, because we're talking about light and dark forces that represent creation and destruction. And you're going to see the destruction in the material form, which is an illusion, according to Doriel and Thoth himself. So that's a kind of a strange thing to say, but other religious disciplines agree that matter is an illusionary state because it's in transition. And we know it transitions back to energy and back and forth. So differentiating between energy and matter is a precept that's given at the first of the tablets. If you'll focus on that and focus specifically when that happens in your body, it'll make a lot of sense. Mm-hmm. Now, I want to put a fork in that one while I'm talking about it. And I did this at the end of the Anunnaki of Nibiru. In Luke 17:20 through 21, Jesus tells... Are you with me?
I'm here, bro. Yeah, I'm listening attentively.
Oh, Jesus tells his followers that don't look outside for in the external material world for the kingdom of heaven, because it's within, meaning where energy meets matter in your body. And Doriel tells us that. Jesus told you that. And Thoth tells you that as well.
Buddha. Okay, so Buddha as so well.
Yeah, it's profound.
Mm-hmm. It's powerful stuff, Gerald. Powerful stuff. And you know what the thing is, well, Gerald, and to bring it back to the actual writing of these on the tablet, this isn't the only tablets in existence. We have the father crispy tablets, that the metal tablets that were found and then obviously then disappeared into somebody's archive somewhere. Most likely the Vatican, but they seized the goods, I think. But yeah, they came from South America. And then we also had the golden book of Joseph Smith as well, and the golden tablets there as well. This is not an unusual idea to be putting information like this on tablets, Gerald.
Right. Yeah, well,
It's profound knowledge, yeah. Wrote down in this very specific way. For, you know, if somebody finds these tablets, Gerald, they're not going to just look at this stuff on the tablet and just go, oh, well, we have all the knowledge now. It's done in a certain way for a certain mind to absorb this, an intelligent mind.
Well, yeah, I think you're right. And what I was trying to go back in my memory and think about was, we can't be aware of anything that we're not at the consciousness level to see.
Mm-hmm.
So as you ascend in your chakras in energy consciousness levels, your awareness expands to the point where you can take on this more advanced knowledge, right? So this is where it gets kind of crazy, is that science is just now catching up where it can understand the Enuma Elish.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm not even sure it's at the place where majority of scientists could even read these emerald tablets and not go, oh, that's ridiculous. They had aircraft and magic weapons that could freeze people and all this stuff 50,000 years ago. Well, that's absurd, right?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's why I think the Emerald Tablets have been out since 1925, translated 1930, and then made available to the world. So a lot of people, and he tells you later in the tablets, a lot of people will look at it and scoff, but the true serious student that reads these and sees the hidden knowledge here, and there's layers of hidden knowledge, okay? It's not all on the surface. They will see it and take it on, and they will change. They'll be transformed.
Mm. So, Gerald, we're talking about Thoth, Hermes, Mercury, Ningishida, Gesida. What was his role? Why was he going around incarnating all this? Did he stay behind when the Anunnaki left? Did he just take on a role and have multiple incarnations? Did he absorb a role on our planet to... You know, did he ally himself with mankind? Did he ally himself with us and then in result say, well, I can't give this knowledge to everybody. I can try and, you know, enhance them, and I can try and enhance these souls to you know, progress and learn and ascend. And the ones that do, I can give them this knowledge in a certain mandate or a certain protocol.
Well, we got a couple of sources about what his mission was. Number one, in the Adapa tale, when he was sent back to the Earth, Ningshida, accompanying the Adapa, okay, he was given a mission to become mankind's teacher. We did that the last show.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, well, how long was that supposed to last? According to Thoth himself, and we're slightly getting ahead of ourselves, he talks about his childhood on Atlantis, his waking up process, and what he chose to do once he got these three mind, body, and spirit elements worked out. Well, he got access to the higher dimensions where he got taught some pretty significant stuff. Well, in that process, he was in Poseidon's temple at one point in the tablets, and he basically talks about his mission to go and be mankind's consciousness coach, whereas he could have gone back to his home and not done this, but he was committed to his mission, which is our reality, okay? So the elevation of human consciousness and learning your life lesson and leaving the simulator, that's his mission, and that's our opportunity to do that, especially at the height of our human consciousness now that we pass through the galactic center, according to this Mayan calendar. Well, that's when our energy state is the highest. That's when your meat modem is lit up to the highest conscious state, so you can be aware of things like the Emerald Tablets, okay?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
See what I'm saying?
Sure. The Emerald Tablets, were they actually made of an actual emerald, or were they emerald in terms of an alchemical substance, Gerald? Do we know anything about the actual physicality of these things?
Well, apparently the emerald is just the color that they are, and it right. turns out to be the same jewel that shows up in the point between the five-pointed star at the spot right where your third eye is. Okay, so they represent that with an emerald jewel. Well, this emerald color shows up on the tablets, and there's your connection with that symbol, by the way.
Wow.
So that's their color, but how he formed them alchemically, he says it was done alchemically, such that they couldn't break the molecular bond and it violated the law of oxidation. I think that may be still a mystery. There may be some great chemists out there that know how to do this now. I personally don't know how they would have done that.
Mm-hmm. Well, Gerald, we're at the top of the first hour. We're going to take a little break there. We're going to come back in a moment, but we are talking to Gerald Clark. You can follow Gerald on GeraldClark77.com. Also, you can catch out his upcoming symposium with yours truly at the Anunnaki Realm of the Maya, and that's going to be at the Equinox event in September later this year. But of course, you can go to Gerald Clark's website, GeraldClark77.com, and you can check out the details there. And don't forget, you can check out his seventh planet, Mercury Rising. But for now, we'll take a quick break, Gerald, and be back in just a moment.
All right, talk to you soon.
Hi everybody, and welcome back to Capricorn Radio. This is your host James, and I'm talking to Mr. Gerald R. Clark, and we are talking about seventh planet Mercury Rising. This is Gerald's latest book in the saga of the Anunnaki, the historical account of our origins. And in this podcast, we're doing some pretty heavy stuff on the Emerald Tablets, but it's fascinating. And the more you look at it, the more you want to know, the more is in it. Are you with me, Gerald?
Yeah, I'm with you, brother.
Oh, it's great to have you back, Gerald. And, you know, I'm just thinking on the break there about the mystery schools. Of course, Doriel was associated with a mystery school, was he? Or in the Brotherhood? Was it the Great White Brotherhood? Something like that?
Yeah, he was. I'd like to go dig in more and find out about this organization that vectored him in 1925 to go get these tablets. It's a place I never really went back to mm-hmm. to try to flush it out, but I think it's interesting.
It's not really much different. I mean, toss the Atlantean priest king with his mystery schools and this, well, knowledge or maybe not secret knowledge, but privied knowledge. You know, is it any different today to the mystery schools today, secret societies? What is the difference, Gerald? They're all talking alchemy and metaphysics.
Yeah, well, so I think the mystery school's goal was always the same, and that was to establish and diffuse to the initiators. And, you know, he's talking about a small group of initiates that eventually gets spread out to the whole world. Well, this was the goal was to connect man the material to man the spiritual. And the link between those two is the mind, which is composed of material and immaterial. So the mind being partly the brain, and then this other aspect of the immaterial. Well, the immaterial that you and I have talked about with my equation 5A is spirit / energy. Mm-hmm. And equation 5A shows the optimum human energy that we should be able to achieve if we're accounting for all the laws of physics, okay, which we may not be.
What Thoth the Atlantean have approved of our enslavement was, I am always of the impression, if he's Ningishida, he was fighting our corner, no?
No, as I said, his mission from Anu was to be mankind's teacher, and his mission from his father when he left Atlantis 50,000 BC was to go over and wake up a bunch of hairy barbarians in the land of Kem and to reestablish the knowledge that was lost when Atlantis was destroyed. And I know later we're going to get into deep discussion about what went down actually that caused the flood that wiped out Atlantis. And it's an interesting story in itself.
It would make sense that you're not going to just want to wake anybody up. It's you're going to wake up the ones that are seeking the knowledge, Gerald. Yeah?
Yeah, well, this goes back to the Bible. And I don't have the verse in front of me, but it's, ask and you'll receive, seek and you'll find, knock and the door will be open to you. Mm-hmm. Well, guess what? We're in this process of reading this deep history. You're seeking. And it's interesting because we just did this Hillbilly Rules of Learning, and I have it encoded in my mind as rote understanding, application, and correlation. But in the rote part, you have QS3R, question, survey, read, recite, review. That's how I remembered it, okay? So he's telling you in this document to not just read it until you get it, even if it takes you 100 times, but he's also promising that if you do that, your wisdom will be increased by 100-fold. Wow, what an IQ bump if you just tended to believe what he said and tried it, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this intellectual portion of man is very important in the tablets, and we're counseled to truly foster our intellectual nature. And the reason being, and we can connect this to some really deep stuff later, is that we can focus all our mental power on a desired plane. Now, what does that mean? What does that mean to you?
That's something I'm seeking. If it's a desired plane, I'm seeking that ascension. I'm seeking that place to go to.
Yeah, well, that's exactly right. And eventually, when you see these holographic models that we're about to introduce to people, we broke it down according to the constructs that were given in the tablets into 14 lower dimensions, 9 parallel dimensions, and then the dimensions that are above us. Okay, so the idea of being able to focus on a plane or a dimension is part of why he's telling you if you want to participate, you've got to develop your intellectual nature. And this turns out to be the secret connection between matter and energy. Okay, so he's telling you differentiate between matter and energy, but you can't do that unless you have an intellect to adjoin those.
Mm-hmm.
And this comes right out of the teachings from Doriel. And, you know, now you understand that the mystery school goal was to connect this man material to man spiritual or energy. So it ties in very well with my path as an electrical engineer to be sensitive to energy and matter.
Wow. This is a massive undertaking by Doriel, really.
Oh, indeed. You know, how did he get the Unicode script that allowed him to translate these ancient Atlantean characters into something that we could read? You know, he must have had some sort of a way to do that. And I don't have access to that. I wish I did.
Do you think perhaps they had artifacts or they had keys to do that? They had some other sort of a decipherment or they maybe had a Rosetta Stone, Gerald?
Well, probably. And, you know, you find out that Thoth was the Lord of Wisdom. He also disclosed ideas about processional cycles and calendars and language to people. So it shouldn't come as a surprise that he probably had some sort of Rosetta Stone for every known language and every translation thereof.
There's certainly an awful lot of knowledge laid down in these texts, these Emerald Tablets, Gerald. It's a serious amount of knowledge, like, that you just couldn't dream up to encode, not in that time frame that these are laid down.
No, and actually, for a serious student, you can look at ancient knowledge from all over the world, the Mahabharata, and on and on and on. You know, all the Sanskrit writings, the Hopi writings, whatever you want, the Mayan codex, you can look at it all. But when you read the Emerald Tablets as a scientist and understand it, it truly takes you to the place where you realize, A, you're caught in a holographic enslavement, okay? and that holographic enslavement, I believe, is the basis for this, I don't know, just primal search by mankind for meaning in this order of reality. Everybody wants to know the answer to this question. What does life mean? And I go pretty deeply into this in the book.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so, but before we start going into that, I just want to reiterate that this veil that Doriel is speaking of now can be understood scientifically.
Mm.
And you know, we talk about the electromagnetic spectrum as being the source of the holographic enslavement, which is energy. So that's why I spent so much time differentiating energy and matter and coming up with equation 5A that I did. Wow. And also, on top of that, through the writings, you'll find out, and Thoth tells you himself, that a quote-unquote false Merkaba field was set up to keep you enslaved. So the only way out of that is described in these tablets as well. So ultimately, to me, this is ultimate knowledge. There's nothing that goes beyond this that I've ever come across. When you truly understand what's going on here.
And that's where you talk about the triggers that's in those tablets. There's triggers in those writings, those, whether it's form, structure, sounds, eloquence of words, or how it sings, how that prose reads. The triggers are there for the ones.
Well, yeah, this is where I talked about this in my first book, about the concept of entrainment, which means you get exposed to some frequency or external energy source that causes you to entrain to that frequency. Well, that's what he's telling you in the Emerald Tablets, is that he wrote this to an Atlantean rhythm that caused a mind frequency or a vibration. Well, that's a form of entrainment. So he's taking you to a mental place such that probably you're receptive to this knowledge and can soak it in more readily, and also see the hidden meaning in it, because some of it's not on the surface.
Wow. Toss the Atlanteans an avatar, then. He's an avatar going, jumping from epoch to epoch as long as he wants.
Yeah, well, he's a time-traveling avatar. You and I are avatars as well, as I described. If we're derived from the Adapa that was created out of a material form and then infused with energy, with a consciousness, he was the first avatar, like we said the last show.
It's incredible, Gerald. Incredible.
Yeah. So something I wanted to kind of launch into about this search for meaning by mankind, probably spawned by the fact that we're caught up in this holographic simulation, mm-hmm. enslaved, wanting to know the way out. Well, the way out is the meaning that we're trying to get for our lives, right?
Yeah.
So in my book, I stated this great search for light and life and love only begins on the material plane. So, if you carry it to its ultimate conclusion, you're talking about universal consciousness, just like that sequence of events that Ian Lundgold released starting October 2011. And this is the true end of the Mayan calendar, not the false 2012 winter solstice date, even though I was duped by that as well until I went back to his research. Okay, so what I wanted to kind of convey before we go too deep into the first tablet was this idea of man's relationship to a relationship. The number phi is a relationship of a numerator to a denominator that gives you this magical 1.618, mm-hmm. right? That shows up in our body, shows up in the planets. Well, let's kind of backtrack before we jumped into that sacred geometry understanding. Let's talk about how we go through this process to get there. Okay? And in my spiritual path, I like to generalize as an engineer. When I come across instances of something, I try to backtrack to the generic rule that would cover all instances. That's just something engineers and scientists do, okay? To look for the general rule, right? So in my process of doing that, I started connecting the dots to Doreal's statement here in the holographic enslavement. He talks about the way out and so on and so forth. Well, this begins when we're kids, establishing a sensory understanding of our physical objective world. And eventually, as we grow up, if you're paying attention, our relationship to objects can be categorized as intelligent or not. So this is where you start understanding this concept and focus on developing the intellectual nature of yourself. It starts very early. So for instance, if you come across a bunch of objects, don't understand the relationship to symmetry in the world and its relationship to beauty and structure, then you'll probably have disorder. And where there's disorder, there's no intelligence, is what he's saying. And the opposite is true as well. If you recognize that the placement of objects, and I'm talking about man's relationship to matter, not other sentient beings yet, okay? So this is just a relationship to your rudimentary physical world. Well, if you notice that if you organize objects and papers and add structure to your life, whatever, so that information is quickly accessible and that the surroundings that you have yourself living in are ordered such that it makes you feel good. There's a deep contrast between that and the way animals live, some that are even so low in the in their relationship matter that they defecate in their own homes and their holes. Okay, that's the other end of the spectrum where there's no reflective consciousness. And he equates the hairy barbarians in the land of Cam living in caves to that when he started. Okay, so once mankind establishes that there's a intelligence in the concept of feng shui, ordering your environment so that the energy not only it feels better, but it looks better to your visual system, right? Mm-hmm. So that's very important, this idea of symmetry. And then you go back all the way to the idea of relationship of phi, of we talked about from the head to the ground and the belly button to the ground in ancient Egypt. They used to use that as your understanding of the proper relationship of your body to its symmetry. So if you had a symmetry of phi, using the longest measurement divided by the shortest one, it should have come out as 1.618. Otherwise, there was a problem. You weren't considered beautiful, right? Well, this is kind of in the concept of feng shui. And one of the penultimate demonstrations for me of feng shui was visiting the Ming Dynasty burial grounds where they had 13 emperors entombed there. Well, if you stand up at one of those buildings, those edifices on that structure, and look at the lake and the mountains and how they set it all up, they had feng shui in mind from the very get-go. It's quite amazing. So beauty is structural symmetry, and that applies to inanimate objects. Optimizing this energetic feel ultimately should lead you to the truth that we're indeed electrical beings. We have an electrical interface to our environment. And now, as science has progressed, we're way beyond just that fundamental relationship. Now we're talking about how electromagnetic spectrum could possibly be emanating from a cell phone and causing a brain tumor. Okay, so we're way beyond just a visual understanding of this.
Mm. You know, so they studied Princess Diana when she died, and because famous people are on their phones all the time, and they knew she used her phone an awful lot, and that she had spots on her brain from the amount of cell phone use that she had.
Yeah, so going forward, after mankind determines what their relationship is going to be to a non-living object, how you order your environment, the next relational learning process that's probably triggered by your latent circuits, by the way, is our understanding of our relationship to each other. So this is a horizontal relationship still, in my opinion, okay? If you took the first one, your relationship to the material world, to its ultimate objective, you would bump up to the place where energy meets matter, okay? Because now you're talking about planets and orbits and galaxies and Van Allen belts and so on and so forth. So let's go forward. This general rule I discovered about relationships, relationship to inanimate objects and structuring and beauty and structure and function, okay? The next level is understanding this horizontal relationship between each other. So when you get to the place where you realize all these beings are the same as you, energetically from the same source, and they're all caught in the holographic simulator just like you, hopefully that will spawn not only stewardship for each other, but also for the animal kingdom as well. And I have to tell you, that's why, one of the main reasons why I'm vegan, okay? Is the understanding of this horizontal relationship with the animal kingdom. Okay, so once you finish this horizontal relationship understanding, at that point in my spiritual path is when you begin to notice that now what you're really looking for is a vertical relationship with the source. And this is the data that shows up in these emerald tablets. Is getting you to the place where you not only understand the vertical relationship, participate with it through the alchemical tradition of transcending your or transmuting your ego and purifying your consciousness. Okay, so a vegan lifestyle, to me, in my path, has been one of the key prerequisites for purification of consciousness. Okay, so purification of energy is what we're saying. Now, think about this. If you go and eat an animal that has been raised to be slaughtered, okay, you're telling me that when they see each other being killed, that they don't have any kind of mortifying response in their system, releasing hormones of fear, just like we do. Well, on top of that, they're being injected with all kinds of steroids and things and antibiotics and such. Well, you're ingesting that when you eat this animal, okay? So you're taking on an energy form into your form that also is composed of energy. So you're taking some of that energy on. Well, do you want that kind of energy in your consciousness or affecting your consciousness? Think about that. So from an energetic standpoint, it doesn't make sense either, okay? So that's I wanted to put a plug in to kind of flesh out this idea of the purification of consciousness in order to participate in this vertical relationship that Thoth gives to us.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, it's pretty clear to me. And actually, I'm telling you this from a pragmatic standpoint. I ate meat most of my life. Raised on a farm, I've seen pigs butchered. I've seen cows castrated or bulls castrated so they would get fat and not chase all the females around. I've seen it all, okay? And I've experienced it all. And I made a conscious choice that I wanted to try something different to optimize my vertical relationship. And I'm telling you, not eating animals is one of those things. Okay?
Wow.
So let's go forward just a little bit farther. So now we did the horizontal relationships with animate and inanimate objects. Now we're focusing on this vertical one. Well, here's where the rules of that game get disclosed to you. And if you're truly a seeking student, these rules are worth learning. Apply whatever methodology you need to. You can use my hillbilly rules. You can listen with an audiobook. Do whatever you have to do. But if you recognize this is ultimate knowledge, take it with you everywhere you go. I did. I carried the Emerald Tablets around with me for years in a notebook, in my work notebook, so that when I had time, I could go back to it. And it took until me recording my audiobook to like truly, truly got it, to be honest with you. Mm-hmm. It's quite amazing. And then in general, I've noticed that when you get exposed to knowledge and wisdom and you decide to learn it at a level that you could teach it to somebody else, something kind of magical happens and you really become the optimal student that you were intended to be, honing your intellect. So teaching things to other people is a really great way to learn it yourself.
Wow. Would you think it would be true to say, Gerald, that the spiritual mind and the intellectual mind are intricately linked so much so that you can't really have one without the other?
Well, this is where I, as an engineer, I see the word spirit, and I immediately equate it with the term, modern physical term, energy. So they are absolutely related.
Hmm. Wow.
So I think intelligence is the bridge for the material brain to the electromagnetic spectrum. And whenever we get to that place in your Cortronic network where this knowledge that you've put up into there and you're churning on it, and it's sitting in your short-term memory trying to turn it into wisdom, this is where you have the potential to have an alchemical interaction, if you will, with the vertical relationship. This is where the holographic simulator managers have an opportunity to see your brain waves modulating your thoughts, okay? Just like a radio. Every thought you have is modulated onto this electrical signal that's generated by your brain. Remember, you're a meat modem. You're out on a remote planet gathering information for your handlers, and you're transmitting all the time. So they know what you're seeking. Why do you think they told you, seek and you will find? How could they know that unless they're involved? And now you realize that we're all avatars on a spiritual journey where spiritual beings have a human experience. That's it. Mm-hmm. And it's part of our evolution of our consciousness to understand these generic relationships, man to inanimate matter, man to man. And if you're still striving against your brother in war, you haven't figured out the horizontal relationship. And especially if you're judging someone else, like we're told in the Bible not to, judge not lest you be judged, right?
Sure.
So judging to me is doing something or saying something to another being that takes them off their spiritual journey that is endemic to them to find the truth. So if you're doing anything to avert somebody from waking up, that's judgment to me.
Yeah. I think we have the science to figure this out now, Gerald. And I know you're applying the chakra wavelengths with the electromagnetic spectrum. And I know that was the thing that grabbed me the most from the Anunnaki of Nibiru book. I was like, wow, this seems a bit obvious. Well, you know, I knew the math and I knew some of the science and stuff, but it seemed very obvious when it was pointed out to me. But, you know, it wasn't ever really understood in that way before.
Until we had the ability to measure the speed of light, have instruments that could read frequency, and that's something else I wanted to bring up. I sent you a little table today from my resonant field imaging. Did you get it?
Oh, sure, yeah.
Okay, well, in that table, it shows you all over the body where you can take this handheld meter with a high-gain antenna and a low-noise amplifier built in, I'm sure, to mm-hmm. gather these frequencies. And the speed of light equals the wavelength times the frequency. You divide the speed of light by the wavelength, and all of a sudden you get the frequency, divide it by the frequency, and you get the wavelength. Well, wavelength is color. So now all of a sudden you can scientifically see the colors of your chakras or your brain waves all over your body, just like that table shows you. So there's a two-dimensional model of the human body with numbers all over it. And places to record frequencies. This was the old method I was using called resonant field imaging. Mm. Okay? So this made it real for me in this distinguishment between energy and matter and realizing that, wow, not only does this body have the potential to hold energy and emanate frequency, not just your brain wave, but also through this electromagnetic interface to your ganglions, okay, your nerve ganglions. These nerve complexes along your central conductor.
Mm.
So now all of a sudden you're in pretty deep where science meets matter, okay? Energy and matter, or some people call it spirit. If the energy is coming from a cell phone and striking or a microwave and it's boiling water or boiling a human, which is 90% water, or your finger or whatever, that's an energy or it's energy interaction with matter. Is it spiritual? And that, so people go, well, I think energy and spirit are different. Yeah, I think they are. But I think spirit is a subset of energy. It's a special type of energy that's got frequency, possibly data modulated on it. So there's a very specific spiritual frequency that we're talking about here. Wow. Does that make sense?
Oh, totally, Gerald. This is a gift. This is a real little gift, a little treasure, these, pardon the pun, like, but they are a real little treasure, these emerald tablets.
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, basically, this hidden mystery is the highest level of knowledge as you seek to understand the state of the world, your relationship to animate matter, people, beings, sentient beings, and ultimately, the ultimate knowledge. And this has been true for all religions, is this vertical relationship with the source. Well, this isn't just dogmatic teaching. This is hard science that we can now investigate. So you talk about a holographic reality and being caught in a sphere surrounded by an electromagnetic spectrum of some frequency or construct such that we're entrapped in it and that we can't experience a higher dimension without knowing the rules of getting out of that. Well, that's what he's telling you in these documents, mm-hmm. especially the later tablets, 14 to 15. But before you get to that, he lays it all out and tells you all kinds of information about the construct of man, how you're composed. We did some of that prematurely, but we did it in Chapter 3 to start introducing some of these energy fields that Thoth discloses. The Ba, the Ka, the Akasic field, and the idea that we're a meat modem that we can receive through our antenna, through the electromagnetic spectrum, and through certain organs in your brain, like the pineal gland, okay, and also transmit. And that's what your brain waves, your heartbeat is probably another frequency that's very important, as well as the frequencies that can be measured from the resonant field imaging and put into the table that I showed you. Once you have them in frequency, you can put it in the software and it'll immediately convert it to wavelength for you. So so you can see the colors of the chakra. Okay. And now all of a sudden you can say, well, how am I doing relative to this evolution of consciousness thing? Well, now you got a number to measure and a visual way to see where you're at.
Mm.
Okay. Well, I did that for many years until I got to the point where it was second nature to me. I didn't even question it anymore. Well, a lot of people in this order of reality still think chakras and human energy and the organ biofield from Wilhelm Reich, that it's all just foo-foo talk. Well, it's not. This is hard science.
Wow. It's no wonder to me that the ancient Egyptians were, the Chimetians, they were so advanced in their spiritual sense, spiritually advanced, the afterlife, and when they had Thoth as their teacher and their guide.
Yeah, yeah. Well, now you realize Thoth was a pretty amazing guy. He introduces himself as the master of mysteries and a magician, a mighty king and keeper of the records. And, you know, he also says he lives from generation to generation, sometimes taking a hiatus in the halls of Amenti, which we just now said has this huge complex identified by Dr. Jim Hertog beneath the Giza Pyramid, which is just a small marker to indicate what's below. Mm-hmm. By the way, the halls of Amenti were later deemed the place where souls went by the Egyptians to meet Thoth, and then they basically had to state a certain number of things to him in order to ascend. And it turns out those things from the Egyptian Book of the Dead,
the Feather of Truth,
were exactly the same as some of the subset of the Ten Commandments that were taken from them.
Mm-hmm.
Really amazing. So the halls of Amenti were then equated with the biblical hell because of that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So now you realize Thoth was the main one going to and from there, and his mission was to deal with these souls that were ascending and descending and learning their life lessons in order to evolve to the place where they could have a vertical relationship and potentially graduate from the simulator. They call them ascended masters, right? Well, he talks about some of those all through the tablets as well.
Sure. Well, Jared, I'm going to finish out the show on the Emerald Tablet 1, unless you've got anything else to add.
I think we're probably at the place where we could do that. At some point, I think we're going to have to talk about what happened on Atlantis and how it came to its end. And I think we got plenty of time to do that because there's a firsthand account of it later.
Mm-hmm.
And when you see that, and realize what's going on right now, with our earth changes and such, you're going to scratch your head and go, oh my God, they're at it again. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, we're talking messing with planetary wobbles in order to cause flood kind of stuff. This is crazy, crazy science. But apparently they understood science at that level. So the idea of heart changing things through the extreme low frequency, messing, you know, using a grid of antennas to focal, and a focal point array on the ionosphere for over the horizon backscatter radar, underground surveillance, you know, like the Sierra radar that this Anwar Sadat was using. All this stuff they knew way back then.
As an amateur radio enthusiast since I was a kid, I understand the HARP technology, trust me, more than anything. I used to be doing shortwave broadcasts, and anybody who does shortwave, they know that the wave hits the top of the atmosphere and comes back down again. That's why it can travel so big a distance. By the time it comes back down, it's gone around half the globe. But, you know, anybody that understands frequency waves or radio waves, what they're doing with the HARP, it's serious. It's really serious.
Yeah, for sure. One other thing that I'll probably throw in before you play the audiobook on the seventh planet Mercury Rising, Chapter 5, Emerald Tablets, is the account that came from Plato. You realize that was the account about in the Critias, where he talks about Atlantis and gives you a whole bunch of detail. And I took some of that out and put it in my first book. And I put some more of it in the second book, where he takes the second part and talks about the destruction of Atlantis, where Zeus gets involved.
Sure.
So through that account and the account from Thoth himself, when you correlate those two, they agree. For the most part, they agree, which is really astounding.
Wow.
And one other thing that I want to point out is in the Halls of Amenti, we talked about this idea in sacred geometry about this symbol, the flower of life, that led Drunvala Melchizedek into this kind of knowledge that Thoth disclosed. Well, that turns out to be a real, kind of a crystal construct that he describes in the halls of Amenti, where he has to go every 100 years out of 1,000 years in order to renew his, whatever he has to do to stay an avatar in that particular body. Every hundred years out of 1,000, he's got to go away and do this. Okay. Well, imagine you're gone for 100 years. What kind of dark lords and sycophants could show up and try to deceive the people, misconstrue the Emerald Tablets, and dismiss them as, you know, garbage, like a certain radio host that I've rebuked a couple times has done. Okay, and I won't say his name, but he knows who he is. Well, Thoth says, do that. And they're warned to keep the doctrine pure, avoid falsely betraying the Emerald Tablets, or suffer a curse that will befall them. He made that promise, and I don't think he's kidding. So, don't treat this document lightly. Seriously, okay? Yeah.
Sure. Well, let me finish out the show, Gerald. And, of course, GeraldClark77.com if you want to follow Gerald's work there. And don't forget the Anunnaki Realm of the Maya Symposium coming up, too. You can check that out on Gerald's site. Or JamesSwagger.com, you'll see the tour and the symposium linked up there. But for now, we're going to finish out the show on Emerald Tablets number one in this episode.
Terrific. I think it's great. I think we got a good start on now organizing the rest of these tablets so that they make sense.
Tablet 1, the History of Thoth the Atlantean. The first rubric asks us to come to a higher awareness and to be open to deeper truths. Thoth introduces himself as an Atlantean, master of mysteries and magician, a mighty king and keeper of the records. He states emphatically that he lives from generation to generation, sometimes taking a hiatus in the halls of Amenti. His goal was to preserve his great Atlantis wisdom for the guidance of those that are to come after his departure from Egypt Khem. And, during his absence, Thoth, having 3 incarnations, originated in his current manifestation in a material body in the great city of Kior on the island of Undal. He does not divulge how long ago it was, but indicates it was a time far in the past. His father, Thotmi, is referenced as the greatest among the children of men, keeper of the great temple. As we know, the Atlanteans were headed by Poseidon Enki and his island kingdom described by Plato in the Critias. Thus, as was in the case in Sumer, Ninshita Thoth is clearly Enki's son. This is yet another AK name for Enki, Ea Nudimmud. Enki Thotmi, dwelling in the great temple of Atlantis, who had the mission of playing liaison between the children of light and the races of men in inhabiting the 10 islands. Thoth's incarnation is distinguished from mankind, stating that he began as a mighty one of Atlantis, living from eon to eon, renewing his life in the halls of Amenti. The source of his Amenti-spawned immortality is given as coming from the river of life that flows eternally onward, reference 10, page 5. Recall the water of eternal life that Anu offered to Adapa during his visit to heaven, Nibiru. Could this be a colloidal solution of monoatomic gold, also known as starfire gold? As discussed in my first book, the Anunnaki elite were clearly partaking of a conical bread cake formed from the white powder found beneath a stone in the floor of Hathor's temple on Mount Sinai. The next line brings into question just how many times Thoth has incarnated versus renewing his current incarnation. 100 times 10 have I descended the dark way that led into light, and as many times have I ascended from the darkness into the light, my strength and power renewed. Thoth indicates that his renewal process in the Amenti longevity chamber is overdue, and that he'll be going there soon. His initial audience is disclosed as those in the land of Khem, or Egypt as we now know it. A prophecy is given that in some unknown future time, Thoth will rise again, mighty and potent, requiring the accounting of those left behind under the tutelage of the priesthood left to guard the Emerald Tablets. They are warned to keep his doctrine pure and avoid falsely betraying the Emerald Tablet lessons, or suffer a curse that will befall them. A brief discussion regarding the fall of Atlantis is presented. Gradually the state of consciousness was eroded in the kingdoms of Atlantis, being replaced with the spawn of a lower star or state of being. At the end of Plato's historical accounting regarding Atlantis, it becomes clear that the high moral character, which was once the aspiration of all island inhabitants, versus material gain came to a cataclysmic end. The reason for the fallen state was attributed to the intermixing of genetic material, leading to a loss of connection to the higher state of consciousness, prolific among the more purebred citizens. Plato's account ends with Zeus being inserted into a judgmental council position, which, from what we know of Enlil Zeus, nothing good could come. Additionally, Thoth indicates that other trouble was afoot, claiming that the dweller of Gwanti was summoned and subsequently changed the flower of life frequency or intensity, or both. Drunvalo Melchizedek wrote two books in a series titled The Ancient Secret of the Flower of Life, reference 32 and 33, in which he describes an energetic grid around the earth whose origins and structures derive from the ancient symbol. Interestingly enough, I learned how to draw this symbol using only a compass. It was used as artwork on one of the didgeridoos I fabricated out of a yucca cactus in San Diego, California. See figure 14 below. Figure 14, Flower of Life Symbol. Now we proceed to the actual text. I, Thoth the Atlantean, master of mysteries, keeper of records, mighty king, magician, living from generation to generation, being about to pass into the halls of Amenti, set down for the guidance of those that are to come after, these records of the mighty wisdom of great Atlantis. In the great city of Kior on the island of Undal, in a time far past, I began this incarnation. Not as little men of the present age did. The mighty ones of Atlantis live and die, but rather from aeon to aeon did they renew. Their life in the halls of Amenti, where the river of life flows eternally onward. 100 times 10 have I descended the heart call that way that led into light, and as many times have I ascended from the darkness into the light, my strength and power renewed. For a time I descend, and the men of Chem is alchemy in ancient Egypt, shall know me no more. But in a time yet unborn will I rise again, mighty and potent, requiring an accounting of those left behind. Then beware, O men of Chem, if ye have falsely portrayed my teachings, for I shall cast ye down from your high estate into the darkness of the caves from whence ye came. Betray not my secrets to the men of the north or the men of the south, lest my curse fall upon ye. Remember and heed my words, for surely I will return again and require of thee that which ye guard. I, even from beyond time and from beyond death, will I return, rewarding or punishing as ye have required your trust. Great were my people in the ancient days, great beyond the conception of the little people now around me, knowing the wisdom of old, seeking far within the heart of infinity, knowledge that belonged to Earth's youth. Wise were we with the wisdom of the children of light who dwelt among us. Strong were we with the power drawn from the eternal fire. And all of these, greatest among the children of men, was my father, Thothmi, keeper of the great temple, link between the children of light who dwelt within the temple and the races of men who inhabited the 10 islands. Mouthpiece, after the 3, of the dweller of Unal, speaking to the kings with the voice that must be obeyed, grew I there from a child into manhood, being taught by my father the elder mysteries, until in time there grew within the fire of wisdom, until it burst into a consuming flame. Not desired I but the attainment of wisdom, until on a great day the command came from the dweller of the temple, that I be brought before him. Few there were among the children of men who had looked upon that mighty face and lived, for not as the sons of men are the children of light when they are not incarnate in a physical body. Chosen I was from the sons of men, taught by the dweller so that his purpose might be fulfilled, purposes yet unborn in the womb of time. Long ago I dwelt in the temple, learning ever and yet ever more wisdom, until I, too, approached the light emitted from the great fire. Taught me he the path to Amenti, the underworld where the great king sits upon his throne of might. Deep I bowed in homage before the lords of life and the lords of death, receiving as my gift the key of life. Free was I of the halls of Amenti, bound not by death to the circle of life. Far to the stars I journeyed until space and time became as naught. Then, having drunk deep of the cup of wisdom, I looked into the hearts of men, and there found I greater mysteries, and was glad. For only in the search for truth could my soul be stilled, and the flame within be quenched. Down through the ages I lived, seeing those around me taste the cup of death, and return again in the light of life. Gradually from the kingdoms of Atlantis, past waves of consciousness had been one with me, only to be replaced by the spawn of a lower star. In obedience to the law, the word of the master grew into a flower. Downward into the darkness turned the thoughts of the Atlanteans. Until at last this wrath arose from his Aguanti, the dweller. This word has no English equivalent. It means a state of detachment. Speaking the word, calling the power. Deep in the earth's heart, the sons of Amenti heard and hearing, directing the changing of the flower of fire that burns eternally, changing and shifting, using the logos until that fire changed its direction. Over the world then broke the great waters, drowning and sinking, changing earth's balance, until only the temple of light was left, standing on the great mountain of Undal, still rising out of the water. Some there who were living, saved from the rush of the fountains. Called to me then the master, saying, "Gather ye together my people. Take them by the arts ye have learned of far across the waters, until ye reach the land of the hairy barbarians, dwelling in caves of the desert. Follow there the plan that ye know of. Gathered I then my people, and entered the great ship of the master. Upward we rose into the morning. Dark beneath us lay the temple. Suddenly over it rose the waters. Vanished from the earth until the time appointed was the great temple. Fast we fled toward the sun of the morning, until beneath us lay the land of the children of Kem. Raging, they came with cudgels and spears, lifted in anger, seeking to slay and utterly destroy the sons of Atlantis. Then raised I my staff and directed a ray of vibration, striking them still in their tracks as fragments of stone of the mountain. Then spoke I to them in words calm and peaceful, telling them of the night of Atlantis, saying we were children of the sun and its messengers. Cowed I them by my display of magic science, until at my feet they groveled when I released them. Long dwelt we in the land of Kem, long and yet long again, until obeying the commands of the master, who while sleeping yet lives so eternally. I sent from me the sons of Atlantis, sent them in many directions, that from the womb of time wisdom might rise again in her children. Long time dwelt I in the land of Kem, doing great works by the wisdom within me. Upward grew into the light of knowledge the children of Kem. Watered by the rains of my wisdom, blasted I then a path to Amenti, so that I might retain my powers, living from age to age a son of Atlantis, keeping the wisdom, preserving the records. Great grew the sons of Kem, conquering the people around them, growing slowly upward in soul force. Now for a time I go among them, into the dark halls of Amenti, deep in the halls of the earth, before the lords of the powers, face to face once again with the dweller. Raised I high over the entrance a doorway, a gateway leading down to Amenti. Few there would be with courage to dare it, few pass the portal to dark Amenti. Raised over the passage I, a mighty pyramid, using the power that overcomes earth force, gravity. Deep and yet deeper place I a force house or chamber. From it carved I a circular passage, reaching almost to the great summit. There, in the apex, set I the crystal, sending the way into the time-space, drawing the force from out of the ether, concentrating upon the gateway to Amenti. Other chambers I built and left vacant to all seeming, yet hidden within them are the keys to Amenti. He who in courage would dare the dark realms, let him be purified first by long fasting. Lie in the sarcophagus of stone in my chamber, then reveal I to him the great mysteries. Soon shall he follow to where I shall meet him, even in the darkness of earth shall I meet him. I, Thoth, Lord of Wisdom, meet him and hold him and dwell with him always. Builded I the great pyramid, patterned after the pyramid of earth force, burning eternally so that it, too, might remain through the ages. In it I builded my knowledge of magic science, so that I might be here when again I return from Amenti, I, while I sleep in the halls of Amenti. My soul, roaming free, will incarnate, dwell among men in this form or another, Hermes, thrice born. Emissary on earth am I of the dweller, fulfilling his command so many might be lifted. Now return I to the halls of Amenti, leaving behind me some of my wisdom. Preserve ye and keep ye the command of the dweller, lift ever upwards your eyes toward the light. Surely in time you are one with the Master. Surely by right you are one with the Master. Surely by right ye are one with the All. Now I depart from ye, know my commandments. Keep them and be them, and I will be with you, helping and guiding you into the light. Now before me opens the portal, go I down in the darkness of night.
This is your host, James Swagger, signing off. Don't forget to check out the full MP3 archive at capricornmembers.com. You can subscribe there. You can also follow the Capricorn Radio YouTube channel, the Capricorn TV YouTube channel, and of course the Capricorn Radio TV Facebook group and Facebook pages. Or you can also follow what I do, James Swagger, in the James Swagger group on Facebook too. And follow all the links for the show on CapricornRadio.com. Greetings, everybody around the world, wherever you may be. You're very welcome to this edition of Capricorn Radio. This is your host, James Swagger, and for the next hour, we'll be getting into some fascinating topics. But before I do, you can check out the links for the live shows at capricornradio.com. We also have a new members area there. You can check out the full MP3 archive at capricornmembers.com. I'm introducing a special lifetime membership fee for Capricorn members. This will entitle you to Capricorn radio shows and Capricorn TV interviews. To sign up for the members area, head over to capricornmembers.com or equally follow the links on capricornradio.com. Don't forget you can also follow the Capricorn Radio YouTube channel, the Capricorn TV YouTube channel, and of course the Capricorn Radio TV Facebook group and Facebook pages. Or you can also follow what I do, James Swagger, in the James Swagger group on Facebook too.
This is your host, James, and I'm super excited today. I've got my returning guest, Mr. Gerald Clark, in the series of podcasts that we are doing. And if you haven't caught the other shows, I urge you to go into the Gerald Clark playlist or catch the archives at Capricorn Members, capricornradio.com. And you can also follow Gerald on his website, geraldclark77.com. And of course, Gerald's most recent book is Seventh Planet, Mercury Rising, and we're focusing on a lot of the information in that book and some background information. However, I have to say we're at a crucial point in the book that I am so excited to be waiting to get to. We've been battling through five shows to get here, and we are going to talk about the Emerald Tablets today. And I have to say, until I read Gerald's book, Seventh Planet, Mercury Rising, and the audiobook for that matter, I wasn't aware in detail of the Emerald Tablets, something I'd skimmed over in my research, and I can be forgiven for that, for all the research that I do. But these things are incredibly fascinating. No problem accepting the deep antiquity of these, but they seem to be murky and where they are now and their location. But here we are today, we're going to talk about these and focus on the work that Gerald has done in linking up the Emerald Tablets to other figureheads in our history and places on the globe. So without further ado, let's bring on today's guest. Hi Gerald, welcome back to Capricorn Radio.
Hey brother, it's so good to be back again. I listened to the last show, it was so exciting, and I'm really, really excited about this one.
I find these shows so beneficial, Gerald, and I know the audience does too, because I'm getting great feedback. And I think that's the beautiful thing, is that there's a dissecting of the history going on, there's an analysis going on, there's an interpretation as well, Gerald, the important interpretation. I mean, I think that's unprecedented, to the depth at least anyway, Gerald, that you're doing. And like I say, that's a unique selling point that you have as an author, and I commend you on that. And that's what we're focusing on in these podcasts. And we're going to try and just, you know, get down to the nitty-gritty and say, what does this all mean? That's the big one, Gerald.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, we're going to talk a little bit just in a while about man's search for meaning. And in a connection to a hero of the past, Viktor Frankl. But we'll save that for a minute, okay?
Oh, sure, sure. You know, Gerald, tell me, before we get into the Emerald Tablets, just tell me a little bit of background. How did you come across the Emerald Tablets? I'll just tell you how I came across them. I came across them in a search and I went, what on earth are these? And I skimmed past it and I just thought, oh, well, it's something I'll come back to. I didn't seem it worthy of anything, but... and I think that's what happens with most people. They come across the Emerald Tablets and they find the story of them and the background information, and then they get into them, and it's incredibly mind-blowing. Tell me, first of all, how you came across the Emerald Tablets.
Well, it was about in the year 2004 when I was researching information on the Anunnaki, and the Anunnaki of Nibiru, my first book. And I was putting together this god table, and these seminal names were showing up, Niburian names and Adamic and us all. So it's really, really profound from that standpoint. So we started out, Doriel says he got the direction as the supreme member or the supreme voice of White Temple or the Egyptian Therapeutate. Okay, so this is the Egyptian priesthood that Thoth assigned to guard these tablets. He asserts that he was a member of that organization, and that's why he was directed in 1925 to go get them. And this is the kind of an interesting story. I'll go ahead and tell it. You realize in Mexico, in the Yucatan, and in South America, according to the history in the tablets, that the Mayan civilizations were there. So they started in South America and migrated over to the Yucatan, according to this. I didn't know that. Well, the 1500s, when the Spaniards came over to Mexico, the Mayan civilization was decimated. So a lot of the temples and things were abandoned. Well, it turns out that according to Doriel, the Emerald Tablets of Thoth had been brought with him to the Yucatan, as we discussed last time, or a couple of times ago. His other name was Quetzalcoatl. So now all of a sudden you realize there's a connection between Egypt and the Yucatan that's so profound. Well, Doriel says that the tablets in 1925 he was directed to go get were in one of those lost temples that was decimated and forgotten about after the Spanish conquest of Mexico. Okay? Well, mm-hmm. That place turned out to be one of the great temples of the sun, and the headquarters of the Mayan civilization at that time was at Teotihuacan, just outside of Mexico. Not Tenochtitlan, which is in the center of Mexico, which Quetzalcoatl also had a temple. Well, the Temple of the Sun and the Temple of the Moon is at Teotihuacan. And not long ago, they discovered a tunnel underneath Teotihuacan where Quetzalcoatl had a significant pyramid structure that was overlooking that area that was separating the Temple of the Sun and the Moon along the Avenue of the Dead. Well, this was probably the place where Doriel recovered these tablets. Now, he originally says there were 10 tablets, these emerald green tablets. And when he translated them, he turned it into originally 13 tablets and then added the two supplements later. That's why we have 15. So my book has all 15 of them, okay? Now, the other kind of interesting part about that is there was an allusion to the document about how it was organized originally. Well, originally it was organized into what was called 7 rubrics. And rubio is a Latin word that means red. And it also ties to the substance orichalcum that was surrounding the pillars of Atlantis. So mm-hmm. You're going to see that the tablets were written by Thoth the Atlantean. Okay, so you're like, wow, okay, Thoth was an Atlantean, but he was also a god in Egypt. Interesting, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
we get the 7 rubrics that are actually dealing with consciousness, vertical relationships between matter and spirit. It describes in the third rubric, it describes the universal life force. Well, now we're getting into alchemy big time, because in this one, it breaks down the 4 elements, correlating fire with calcination, water with dissolution, air with separation, and earth with conjunction. And people that are into alchemy know what those terms mean, okay? So all of a sudden, he's basically disclosing that he's not only the first alchemist, but he's doing it with 7 rubrics, and he also gives you the 7 main elements of alchemy. Okay, so in the next rubric, he talks about entering the spiritual realm or the above. Okay, now this is, we're going to get into that. There's several allusions to that, but when you use the word above, you go, well, okay, is there above and a below? Is there a separation? And as you're going to see eventually, on the earth, we are enveloped in what's called the below the other dimensions that are higher than us. And we get real specific about what that means, okay? So we'll just keep the idea of above and below, and we'll take it even a step further, and we'll call the below the holographic universe where we're enslaved in our current consciousness. All right, I'll just put that out there. So in Egyptian names, and one of those names, not to do them all right now, was Thoth. And it talked about how long, Manetho discussed how long he ruled the first dynasty of Egypt. And about that time, I ran across the name Thoth and discovered the Emerald Tablets by Doriel. And I didn't know who this Doriel was, and my first reading of it was cursory, like yours. But something struck me in the reading, and so much so that I decided to make a little 4 or 5 page Microsoft Word summary of the lessons I had garnered from it. And I carried this around with me for a while. I'm not sure why, but there were certain lessons in there that just really stuck with me. One of them was banishing darkness that shows up in tablet 6, but the ones that really struck me between the eyes were the supplemental tablets that were not supposed to be released until a specific time in history, the future time that Thoth declared, or when he would come back and hold people accountable for it. That part was, those two tablets were 14 and 15, and we'll talk about the different organizations of the tablets and some history and all that kind of stuff in a minute. But so I ran across them about the year 2004, mm-hmm. and I've probably read them multiple times. I've lost count, but I read them to the point where I felt like I understood them, and it doesn't happen the first time. And the thing about the nature of the tablets is the information is so incredible that it's even beyond our modern science, so much so that it was probably dismissed as fantasy.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But now that science has gotten to the place where we can look at it through a scientific perspective, I think the preludes I did to each tablet use that perspective, and I think you'll see that it all hangs together very, very well.
I think that's the most important thing you just said there, Gerald, was that now that the science has caught up and we're looking at these things, what the stuff and the information that's contained in those emerald tablets, you know, you just couldn't make that up in the past. It checks out on so many accounts. It just makes so much more sense when you look at it from the eyes of a scholar. And that's something, like I say, I skimmed over. I actually got forced to read it because it was in your book. So I commend you on that, Gerald, for putting it in there. I know why you did, and that's great. But like I say, it's something that people just find and they skim over and they just don't take it on or whatever. But I'm glad I did, because I've really missed the boat on it. And the more I look at the Emerald Tablets and the more I read them, it's something, it just kind of hits you the first time. And then the second time you say, it's like anything, it's like any subject matter. You get hit with a wall of information, and then the second time you soak it in, and the third time you get real deep, profound meaning from it. Before I guess I continue any further, Gerald, let's, for those listening, and probably we've done enough to allure them now, but tell us what exactly the Emerald Tablets are. I know they've been lost to history now, but they are being translated in history, and there are records of them. So tell us what they are, who wrote them, when, why, what did they look like, all that type of stuff, the physical story.
Okay, you want me to? Well, you want to stay on the physical story and not so much the historical story. Well,
just for the background for the audience,
okay.
Who don't.
Okay,
just,
so what are the Emerald Tablets? According to Doriel, who says he got his hands on them circa 1925, there were 15 total tablets, and he was allowed to release 13 of them until a certain time. Okay, so with that, telling that story, the first thing in your mind is, well, where were they and all that kind of stuff. So let's stay on the physical right now, and then we'll kind of walk through the pathway they've taken and the connection to the Mayan calendar, okay? So supposedly they're emerald green tablets that are written in the ancient Atlantean script, which is done in a way that's rhythmic and causes a mental frequency to occur when you hear them. So that's the other thing that's important about the Emerald Tablets, is you can read them and only get so much, but when you read them aloud or listen to the audio, they're done to a specific rhythm that causes mental entrainment that supposedly, according to the writing, triggers a conscious movement of your soul that releases a deep wisdom and an understanding that's already in the fourth rubric. In the above, he finishes off the seven alchemy elements of fermentation, distillation, and coagulation. And Krista, being an alchemist, is sitting over here smiling because she knows exactly what I'm talking about. Okay? Mm-hmm. So the fifth rubric, this is original organization of the tablets, okay? There was a pure quintessence resulting from the last rubric. In other words, it's an accumulation of all the previous four rubrics. The sixth one gave you a meta perspective that leads to a transformation in your consciousness so that you can either distinguish and participate in a multidimensional reality. So eventually we're going to talk about the worlds within worlds that ties us back to the Mayans again, okay? Mm-hmm. So in that rubric, endemic are the laws of the evolution of matter and the forces in nature. So it's very, very profound. And then the last rubric, it really kind of goes into talking about who Thoth is as an immortal, and that he was called thrice great Hermes for a particular reason, because he had conquered the physical, the mental, and the spiritual realms of reality. Okay. I used to think it meant his number of incarnations, but then I saw the tables from Edgar Cayce and my own research to realize he had so many other names and incarnations. I was struggling with, well, is that the prolongation of one body through all this time, or is it multiple incarnations in other bodies? Well, it turns out he can do both, so it's really crazy.
Wow.
Okay.
This is incredible stuff, Gerald. The structure of the...
It's absolutely amazing.
The structure of the rubrics, the structure of the information, as well as the paragraphs, if you want to call them that, or the way it's spoken as well, and you get that effect. We're going to play that at the end of the show anyway. But the spoken word, as they say, the embodiment of the alchemical knowledge plus... the structure of the prose on the tablet as well. This is incredible stuff. I mean, how far back into history does this stuff go? I mean, from my own research, I'm just looking at there's translations from Newton. Newton was a known alchemist. Perhaps that's probably where he got his alchemy craze from. Perhaps this source of stuff. Do we know how far back into history this goes? Obviously, it goes back to the source, but...
Well, he tells you in the history of the tablets and discloses, it's hard to go, okay, back to the source of when this started without talking about Atlantis. So let's put Atlantis off for just a little bit, but just know that Thoth was an Atlantean. Atlantis was destroyed, and during that destruction, his father ordered him to go to the land of Cam and do a mission. Well, he says he left Atlantis 50,000 years ago. 50,000 BCE, and ruled over Egypt for what looks like until 36,000 BCE, when he apparently descended into the halls of Amenti to renew his body. And this is something in the tablets you'll see later. He does it out of 1,000 years. He has to go there for 100 years to renew. Yeah, that's kind of crazy. So, and he says he's done that 1,000 times. Okay, that means in the current body that he's in, his Thoth, he's been doing it for 100,000 years. Okay, that may sound incredible, but you go look at the Sumerian kings list and see how long some of those rules were ruling. And like I told you, the one at Bad Tabir served 12 shards, which is about 43,000 years. So so this is incredible stuff, okay?
So it's on a par with the Anunnaki kings list and time frames, really.
Well, exactly. Well, Thoth the Atlantean was Enki's son, who was from Nibiru. And he also had other names, as I told you before. In the Enuma Elish, which was the Babylonian epic of creation, according to the Anunnaki that was given to the Sumerians, he had a name in that account as well, along with Ea, Enki, and Nutamud, okay? Well, his name was Mumu, which equated him with the planet Mercury in the table in my first book, The Anunnaki of Nibiru. Okay, so the fact that the alchemy esteems the mystical element of mercury, a liquid metal that can be in multiple different states. Mm-hmm. You know, it could be a vapor state. Its natural form is in a liquid state, but it's a crazy substance. It doesn't emit its own light. It reflects only what is it's exposed to. It can absorb other metals. It's really an amazing
material. Exotic, Gerald. It's an exotic substance.
Yeah, well, it also shows up in the toroid shape engines of the Vimanas as spinning mercury. And so even the founder of the Qin dynasty created a whole underground city representing of his capital where he had mercury rivers flowing in it. And apparently he was consuming the stuff too that had led to his early demise. Wow.
Did you ever hear the phrase "mad as a hatter"?
Sure.
That comes from
mercury poisoning.
Yeah, they used to get the red cinnabar and process it for dye to dye hats, and as a result, they would all have mercury poisoning, going literally insane with heavy metals. So wow. the people who made the red hats became mad as a hatter, like basically.
That's interesting. The concept of cinnabar and what shows up in the Magnus card has my attention. I'm gonna have to go back and look at that because he talks about that in his process of doing the laws of continuous creation while he's holding his scepter at the table. It's crazy. Anyway, so 50,000 years ago, Thoth leaves Atlantis as Thoth the Atlantean, and he talks about his youth there at a later tablet. Okay, and up to 36,000 BCE, where this is really key to me, and I got very confused, and I only found the answer today. I have stated multiple times that Thoth built the Giza Pyramid and the Sphinx to commemorate it as an above ground structure in the Giza complex. Okay, well, a lot of people have looked at the Sphinx, looked at rain erosion, and tried to establish through archaeoastronomy and other things, documents, mm-hmm. when the pyramids built. Okay, well, I was of the opinion based on the Emerald Tablet reading that he built them. He did it in the age of Leo, because you see the Sphinx is a lion's body. That's clearly a zodiacal sign. And then it has his face on it, which is kind of disfigured after Napoleon went over there and multiple others and were firing cannons at it, trying to break off the beard and everything else. That's why it's been reconstructed. It's been under attack. And speaking of that, bringing us current just for devastating cultural sake, knowing that the Mosul library was just ransacked and over 8,000 books and ancient scripts of Sumerian origin and cuneiform script were destroyed by ISIS. Okay, their next statement, just a couple, not even a week ago, from their religious leader and their military leader was the Giza complex is next. Mm-hmm. So wow, that's unbelievable. Okay. But it has precedence in history. You know, Napoleon went over and did it, and I'm sure others have as well. Maybe Saladin, I'll have to look. So getting back to the history. So these tablets ended up in this temple, Teotihuacan, under the Pyramid of the Sun. That's why that's so important to me, and I was hoping to do another show from that spot with you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They were recovered 1925 by Doriel under the direction of the White Temple, the Egyptian Therapeutate, the priesthood, okay? Well, he took them, translated them into these 15 tablets, and then, according to his instructions, they did not put these complex, and most people believe that the Sphinx. Well, he tells, so about 1925, he was directed to go get these emerald tablets from beneath the Temple of Teotihuacan, and like I said, they discovered the underground chamber there not long ago. He did his translation into these original 13 tablets, which started from a different organization. This is his organization, okay? And then withheld the tablets 14 and 15 until a later time. So by the time I got to the Emerald Tablets in 2004, 14 and 15 were included. So I'm not sure exactly when 14 and 15 were made available, okay? So from that point, he did his translation, released his document, and according to him, it's been released since 1925.